Welcome. Welcome to the Mike Lazaridis Theater of Ideas here at Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. And welcome to this, the second special public lecture as part of Convergence. My name is Greg Dick. I'm the Director of Educational Outreach here at Perimeter, and it is a pleasure to welcome everyone here this evening, both those of you here in the live studio audience and those of you watching online, either on Perimeter's website or on one of our many science communication colleagues' websites around the globe. We are also very pleased to welcome many of our valued public and private partners who are here in the audience this evening, supporters of the Kremble, Hamilton, and Galileo chairs, and supporters and individuals from foundations and corporate supporters. Thank you all. Now, tonight's lecture is part of a special conference called Convergence. Convergence is an event that is bringing together some of the world's top minds in physics to probe the latest ideas in the field and chart a course for 21st century physics. I would like you to join me in acknowledging the presenting sponsor of Convergence, BMO Financial Group. Thank you, BMO. Now, tonight's lecture will last approximately 1 hour and will be followed by a question and answer session. For those of you watching online, we have Dr. Kelly Foyle and a team of PI researchers behind their keyboards at the ready in the chat zone, ready to engage in conversation throughout the lecture. If you want to participate in that discussion, use hashtag PIConverge. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's very special guest speaker, Dr. Jürgen Renn. Dr. Renn is the director of the Max Planck Institute for the History of Science. He studies structural changes in the systems of knowledge, aiming to better understand knowledge evolution. He has studied some of the great transformations of systems of physical knowledge, such as the origins of theoretical science in antiquity, the emergence of classical mechanics in the early modern era, and the revolution of modern physics in the early 20th century. In celebration of the 100th anniversary of Einstein's general relativity, tonight, Dr. Jürgen Renn will trace the genesis of general relativity in the context of physics, math, and philosophy. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Jürgen Renn.
It's really exciting for me to be part of this. And one of the things that I would like to convince you of tonight is that not just physics, but also the history of physics presents exciting problems to think about, challenges, intellectual challenges. And as you can see from the list of names here, history of science and not just physics is also teamwork. So I will be presenting the work of our team on the history of general relativity and its renaissance to you tonight. So, what is the challenge that general relativity created by Albert Einstein in 1915 presents for a historian of science? Now, it's actually very simple. The theory emerged in the hands of Albert Einstein, although there was no pressing empirical problem, no riddle of experiments or astronomical observations. The only thing that the theory immediately tried to explain was the slight perihelion shift of Mercury, an effect that was known since the late 19th century and that Newtonian planetary theory failed to explain. But there might have been other explanations for it, and astronomers didn't consider it as a major challenge. Light bending by gravitation, redshift, the expanding universe, gravitational lensing, black holes, all of that, all of these wonderful results that today's astrophysics presents us with, came only later, after Einstein had formulated his theory in 1915. So, on what knowledge was general relativity built? Now, there are two obvious possibilities, or at least one of them is obvious. The typical approach of traditional history of science is there's a lonely genius who thinks differently from anybody else and creates it out of his own ingenuity. Now, that is not the explanation that I will give you tonight. I will give an explanation that is much more in tune with the theme of this Convergence conference that we have just heard about. The creation of general relativity emerged from a transformation of the knowledge that had been accumulating in the course of time in the various branches of classical physics. And Einstein and his collaborators brought this knowledge together and transformed it into the theory of general relativity. Now, I have just mentioned Einstein and his collaborators. Einstein was not such a lonely genius as he is often portrayed, and we will see in the course of this lecture how many collaborators actually contributed to the creation of general relativity. But still, let us take a look at the main protagonist himself, just to get you familiar with the time and space in which our story happens. So Einstein was born in Ulm in Germany. He spent his school period in Munich. And when he started to work on the problem of relativity, when he published his theory of special relativity in 1905, he was just a patent clerk at the Swiss Patent Office in Bern. And when he had the first ideas that would lead him to general relativity, the idea of a generalization of the relativity principle to include accelerated motion, he was still just a patent clerk at the Swiss Patent Office. His academic career took only off a little later. In 1909, he became an associate professor at the University of Zurich. Then he became a full professor for the first time at the German University in Prague. And then he went back to Zurich. And in 1914, at the time of the outbreak of the First World War, he got the privileged position of an academy professor at the Prussian Academy of Sciences in Berlin. And there it is where he finalized the theory of general relativity on November 25th of 1915. And this is why we are celebrating the centenary. So let us take a little bit closer look. So special relativity is 1905. The first thought of a generalized relativity principle is 1907. And then another milestone is the realization that gravitation can be described by a metric tensor. Now, what is a metric tensor? A metric tensor describes the geometry of space and time. And so it makes the stage in which physical processes are happening, space and time, part of the dynamics of physics. Because the theory of general relativity tells us that this curvature, this geometry of space and time, is actually governed by the matter and the energy in the universe. So the metric tensor, as a description of that geometry, was an idea that Einstein formulated in 1912 when he was just on his way back from Prague to Zurich to his second full professorship. And in 1915, as I told you, he formulated general relativity as we know it today. So there are more than 2.5 years that is ruled by something else that is written here as Entwurf theory. Now, what is the Entwurf theory? It's a predecessor theory of general relativity. Entwurf in German means draft or outline theory. Einstein initially carefully, prudently called it that way. And it's, of course, forgotten because now we have this beautiful building, this beautiful result of general relativity on which even today's cosmology and astrophysics is still built. And so we forget about the predecessor. But in my story, in my historical story, this predecessor theory will play a very important role because it is here that we understand how Einstein actually came to this, and I would like to remind you, surprising result of formulating a theory that is now the basis for much of astrophysics and cosmology without Einstein having familiarity with these modern results. So what was the first thought that brought Einstein into the theme of general relativity? It was a review article. In 1907, he was asked to write a review about his theory of special relativity because special relativity established a new framework of space and time, and Einstein was asked to review all of the physical phenomena known at that time from this perspective, integrating it into this framework of space and time. Now, it turned out for gravity, that was a problem. Simple properties of gravity, as they were known from Newtonian physics, didn't seem to fit, weren't easily adapted to this new framework of special relativity. So gravity became a special problem. Now, others might have tried to squeeze gravity into the framework of special relativity, but for Einstein, this challenge meant to question the framework that he established, that he had established just 2 years ago. So he thought anew about the problem of space and time, understanding that gravity was part of it. One of the problems that he dealt with was what is called Galileo's principle. So Galileo, in 1610, had discovered that all bodies fall with the same acceleration. So when I drop an object from one particular height and I look at another object, say a projectile that has a horizontal speed, but that is falling from the same height, they come to the ground at the same point in time. Now, this simple insight didn't seem to fit with a straightforward generalization of special relativity to the phenomena of gravitation. So that made Einstein think about how gravitation is described in classical physics, in Newtonian theory. And he found it a remarkable fact that you have two concepts of masses, inertial mass and gravitational mass, who in Newtonian physics are conceptually quite distinct, but numerically they are always the same. In fact, they must be the same, because only in this way you achieve the result that all bodies fall with the same acceleration. So that made him think about the relation of gravitation and inertia. And then he came up with a wonderful idea, which he later designated as the happiest thought of his life. Namely, that gravitation and inertia are more closely related to each other than had been anticipated in classical physics. In fact, he thought maybe gravitation and inertia, and by inertia here I mean, you know, the effects of push and pull that you feel in an accelerated laboratory, or when you move in an accelerating car or in an airplane that takes off, you feel that something pushes you against the seat. This is because of the acceleration of the airplane, and it's called an inertial force in classical physics. Now, Einstein thought that that inertial force is closely related to gravitation, just like magnetic forces and electric forces are just two sides of the same coin, namely of an electromagnetic field. So he thought maybe there is something like a gravito-inertial field. Gravitation and inertia are just two aspects of the same field. Now, that sounds very abstract, but it did give him a wonderful idea, namely the idea that I can simulate gravitational effects by accelerated motion. So I can imagine that this elevator, this box here, is somewhere in outer space, and there is a pull that accelerates it, but the person who doesn't have a window to look outside cannot distinguish whether he feels a gravitational field or whether he is subject to these inertial forces due to acceleration. So to some extent, gravitation and acceleration are interchangeable, and so I can simulate effects of gravitation to some extent by considering accelerated motion. Now, that's a very unusual thought. But there was a background for this thought. Einstein had read Ernst Mach, a physicist who was also a philosopher and a historian, so you can imagine I pride myself that a historian of science and a philosopher of science gave Einstein an important idea, because Mach had questioned a very old thought experiment due to Newton. Newton had considered the rotation of a bucket with water in it, and once the water is set into motion, the surface of the water curves, and Newton has ascribed this effect to absolute space, as he called it. And Mach objected, maybe this is not due to absolute space, but this could be the effect of an interaction between the mass of the water here and the distant stars of the universe. So Mach didn't think about gravitation in this case, but Einstein did. Einstein imagined, if there is such a close relation between gravitation and inertia, then maybe this is an example of a dynamical effect due to this generalized gravito-inertial fields. So that he used now as a heuristic device to imagine a theory. He didn't have a theory yet. He had just these thought experiments and these general ideas. So what would this theory have to look like? If I can simulate gravitation with these effects of accelerated motion, I can infer a lot of properties of what later became general relativity just in this heuristic qualitative way. For instance, I can infer that light must be bent in a gravitational field, or that there must be a gravitational redshift. He even speculated as early as 1907 about the possibility of explaining the perihelion shift of Mercury, about which we have just talked, by such a generalized theory of gravitation. So Einstein had many of the qualitative, the conceptual insights due to these early thought experiments before he had any mathematical theory to describe them. How did he sustain this highly original perspective? I told you Einstein was not alone. He was surrounded by friends who supported his rebellious anti-authoritarian attitude with regard to the establishment of physics. So I cannot describe in detail here the role of all of these friends, his wife Mileva Maric, Marcel Grossman, the friends from the Academy Olympia, Michele Besso and his wife, with whom Einstein was in constant exchange. But I would like to distinguish two persons that play an important role in my story. One is Marcel Grossman, himself an established mathematician and later colleague of Einstein as a professor at the Polytechnical School in Zurich. His first deed that he did for Einstein was that he helped him survive university, because Einstein didn't go to his lectures. Grossman did, and so when it came to exams, you know, Einstein was relying on the notebooks of this guy here. Otherwise, he wouldn't have passed the exam. And then after he had finished university, Einstein was desperately looking for a job. He was really despairing. He would have been happy with the lowliest job offer. And the one who saved him was again Marcel Grossman, because the job at the patent office, it was through Marcel Grossman that Einstein got it. The other person I want to single out is Michele Besso. Now here we're talking about somebody who is academically much less established than Marcel Grossman. He was an engineer, and only with a lot of difficulty, and with Einstein's help, he managed to survive in his job in the patent office. So he never made a great academic career. Yet he was, I would say, perhaps Einstein's most important interlocutor, not only during the time when he created general relativity, but through the rest of his life. They died in the same year, 1955, and to the end of their lives, even when Einstein was in Princeton, having to emigrate from Germany after the taking of power of the Nazis, they constantly exchanged letters about everything, the human things, science, so a very, very important person. And it's probably very little known that this person also played an important role in the history of general relativity. So I was talking about the qualitative insights that you could gain even without having a formal theory. And of course, the role of these, you know, freewheeling discussions with friends. So when Einstein understood that his new theory would predict effects, the effect that light is bent in a gravitational field, he was desperately looking for attention from the astronomers that could tell him how this effect might be observed. And they were completely disinterested. The German astronomers of the time were just, you know, tuned to precision management measurements, to precision measurements, and they were not interested in basic physical ideas. Einstein found attention. The first astronomer he found was this guy here, a young astronomer in Potsdam, Erwin Freundlich, who helped Einstein, you know, developing the first ideas about how the astronomical effect of general relativity might be observed. And again, we're talking 1912, that is still 3 years from the final theory. And one of the notebooks, here you see one of Einstein's little notebooks, you know, here's a puzzle, you know, whereby he demonstrates that all triangles are equilateral, okay. Here's an address from a visit in Berlin, and here, in this drawing, we find the first theory of gravitational lensing. Now, gravitational lensing is today not just a subject of research, it's one of the most important tools that astronomers have to look far into the universe. And here's Einstein, you know, together with the young astronomer Freundlich in Berlin, during a visit in Berlin, you know, developing the theory of gravitational lensing, and it was actually only published 24 years later. Again, this is all before Einstein had any formal theory. But of course, he needed a formal theory. So, but let me briefly come back to my initial claim. General relativity emerged as a transformation of the knowledge of classical physics. We have already seen this business about gravitation and inertia, which Einstein called the equivalence principle, because of the equivalence between gravitation and inertia under certain things. That was already built into classical physics. But the close relation between gravitation and inertia wasn't noticed because gravitation was considered a force and inertia, as we have seen with Newton and Mach, a property of space. So Einstein looked at things that were known in principle, but from a new perspective. And then I've told you that Einstein coined this idea of a gravito-inertial field in analogy to the electromagnetic field. That's what it was. An important insight, not because of the heuristics following from it, but it was also, it gave him a clue how to formulate a theory of this gravitational, gravito-inertial field, namely by following the well-established example of electromagnetic field theory. So the earliest attempts by Einstein to formulate a mathematical theory of this new field closely followed the analogy of Maxwell and Lorentz and others who had elaborated an electrodynamic field theory, an electromagnetic field theory. So how does such a field theory look like? It has an equation of motion where the field tells matter how to move, and it has a field equation where matter tells how the field has to be distributed in space and time. So these two components is what determined the rest of our stories. He had to find an equation of motion, and he had to find a field equation. So the first attempts in doing so, in accomplishing this, are again found in this notebook from Einstein's time in Prague. And this one page here is actually an entire theory, a few formula, an entire theory. Einstein first carefully approached the special case of a static gravitational field. This is how you would proceed in electromagnetism as well. You would start with an electrostatic field before you go to the full Maxwell equations. So that's exactly what he did. And if you look closely, you see exactly this structure. You have a relation between a field and a potential, and you have a relation between a source that tells how the field has to look like, that is the field equation, and you have the equation of motion where the field tells matter how to move, how to accelerate. So we see already the full structure in this very primitive, you see there's no new mathematics that you can easily write down, you know, you can do it as a homework for school almost. That is what Einstein set out with. So, and then we are now in the summer of 1912, we are approaching this major milestone that I have mentioned in the beginning, namely Einstein realizes that the equation of motion is actually something that you can describe very simply by looking at space-time as described by a curved geometry. He introduced the metric tensor as representing the gravitational potential, and he realized that free particles in this curved space-time move along the straightest possible path. So this is a generalization of the inertial principle to curved space and time. So he had already, in the most general case, resolved one of his two problems, namely the problem of the equation of motion. And the problem that occupied him for the remaining 3 years was to find a field equation. Now that's very understandable, because the metric tensor that allows you so easily to write down the geodesic equation, this equation describing the straightest possible path in a curved space-time, has 10 components. Now, you imagine you have to find a differential equation for these 10 components. And also, even at that time, Einstein knew that this would have to be a non-linear differential equation, and he had no clue as for the mathematics that was required in order to solve this problem. So he had well set out his physical program, but his mathematics was far from sufficient to actually go beyond what you see in these first pages. This is now another notebook. It's called the Zurich notebook because this is from the time that Einstein was in Zurich, starting in the summer of 1912. And you see, you know, this is the metric tensor. Then there's the static theory that we found before. And Einstein is just trying to puzzle all of this together. So let's contrast that with the final result. Now, these are the field equations, and I'm not asking you to understand them in detail here, from November 25th, 1915. So I've called them here a beautiful arch. This is the beautiful arch that Einstein erected. But what about the scaffolding? How was this arch actually erected? Now, you might think that the easiest way is to ask Einstein himself. So what did the great old man say himself about how he achieved that beautiful arch? So I'm going to read you now a passage from his autobiographical notes that he set down writing in 1949. "I have learned something else from the theory of gravitation. No collection of empirical facts, no matter how comprehensive, can ever lead to the formulation of such complicated equations. They can only be found through the discovery of a logically simple mathematical condition that completely or almost completely determines the equations. Once one has those sufficiently strong formal conditions, one requires only little knowledge of facts to set up a theory." So in short, Einstein said this was basically a mathematical guess, an ingenious mathematical guess. And there are many other statements in this direction. Nevertheless, no, we are not yet at the nevertheless, so you can imagine the nevertheless will come. So if we compare this now with one of the publications that prepared the final run to the field equation in 1915, and there were actually four papers, one after the other, that Einstein submitted to the Prussian Academy in November 1915. He there writes, "I completely lost confidence in the field equation of the Entwurf theory." There it is again, you remember this draft theory, this outline theory, "and looked for a way that would constrain the possibilities in a natural manner. I was thus led back to the demand of a more general covariance of the field equation, which I had abandoned with a heavy heart 3 years ago when I was collaborating with my friend Grossmann. In fact, back then, we already came very close to the solution of the problem given below. Hardly anybody who has truly understood the theory will be able to avoid coming under its spell." Very self-conscious, the man. It is a real triumph of the method of the general differential calculus developed by Gauss, Riemann, Christoffel, Ricci, and Levi-Civita. After what has been said so far, it is natural to posit, and then he goes with the field equation. Not yet the final, but almost the final ones. So again, this seems to speak in favor of a turn away from physics and towards mathematics that would suggest the most natural field equations. So if we look back now, because we do have the historical evidence, at this notebook where we find Einstein's calculations together with Grossmann, we do exactly find, here it has the Ricci tensor, which is one of those generally covariant objects, as the mathematicians say, that promise to fulfill his dreams about a general principle of relativity, and he extracts from him what he from the Ricci tensor what he calls a probable gravitation tensor. And most remarkably, here you find the name of Grossmann. This is Marcel Grossmann, because Einstein's mathematics was still not up to the point. He had to ask Grossmann to give him this object, write it down nicely, so he would draw the physical consequences from it. So, in fact, Einstein is right. He had already in 1913 found the object that he would later publish in 1915. But he couldn't accept it on physical grounds. It seemed to violate the conservation of energy momentum, one of the basic requirements of a good physical theory, and it did not reduce, or so Einstein thought, to the Newtonian theory in the appropriate limits. So it was mathematically beautiful, but physically unacceptable. So what now? Is the physics or the mathematics here in the driver's seat? We have looked at this question in great detail, and we have found that when Einstein makes these pronouncements on why the mathematics was in the driver's seat, or that the mathematics was in the driver's seat, he's actually suffering from a case of self-serving selective amnesia. Because at the time that he was making those statements, he was desperately working on a unified field theory, trying to unify the gravitational field with the electromagnetic field, and he had no other clue to go for than beautiful mathematics. So he kind of remembered that he had done it once, and if he had done it once, he could achieve it twice. So we have to look ourselves for the historical documents. It's a general experience that one has when one looks at the recollections of famous scientists. You know, you have to look what they actually did and not what they say that they did. It's really different. So, you know, again, this is the team that we worked. Actually, we worked, I have to admit, longer than Einstein himself worked on his theory of general relativity, we worked on reconstructing it. Okay, so you can see we were all much younger then. But we have a wonderful material, historical material. We have this wonderful notebook, the Zurich notebook. We have the correspondence with Bessel, with other friends, that allows us step by step to reconstruct this. So Einstein starts with a tinkering phase, you know. And what he does in this tinkering phase is very plausible. That's what you would do as well. He starts with his intuitive, qualitative, heuristic insights about rotation, about an accelerated frame of reference, and he tries to translate that into mathematical principles. So one of the secrets of this dynamics of the creation of general relativity is exactly this, the interaction between the conceptual insights and the mathematical formalism. And none of it is really stable. Both are in motion and are interacting with each other. I told you that, you know, on the mathematical level, this is really primitive. You can even see that Einstein develops his own pedestrian mathematics. But then Grossman comes. Again, you know, you always see in the crucial moments Grossman's name. And Grossman suggests the mathematics that we have already heard about of Gauss, Riemann, Christoffel, Ricci, Levi-Civita, and so on, called at the time the absolute differential calculus. And it provides generally covariant objects. General covariance means these objects maintain the same form in whatever coordinate system you write them down. So they seem to fulfill this promise that of a generalized theory of relativity in which you could use whatever coordinate system you choose. Now, what Einstein does here, he takes, you know, such a generally covariant object, and he immediately checks, which is the most natural thing to do, whether it satisfies the Newtonian limit, because the theory has to touch base with what you already know about gravitation, and that is mainly Newton's law. And it doesn't. So here it fails right on the first page. So Einstein now is torn between the physics and the mathematics. But he now cleverly devises a strategy, a double strategy, a physical strategy and a mathematical strategy. From the mathematical strategy, he gains objects, general covariant objects, that he then checks for the correspondence with Newton's law and whether they fulfill energy momentum conservation, the other major requirements. That is the mathematical strategy. The physical strategy starts from objects that already fulfill the Newtonian limit, and then he tediously tries to generalize them. So once again, because this is really important, the mathematical strategy, you extract a candidate of broad covariance and you check it against, the mathematical strategy starts from objects that already meet, you know, the highest dreams of Einstein about the general principle of relativity. And then you have to check the down-to-earth physical requirements, like whether the theory satisfies the Newtonian limit. The physical strategy proceeds in the opposite way. You start from objects that fulfill the physical requirements, and then you check how mathematically reasonable they are. And you can see it back and forth, all the time in the Zurich notebook. And this is one of the most exciting pages in the Zurich notebook, because what you see here, albeit in linearized approximation, is the correct solution, the real correct solution of 1915, of November 25th, 1915. These are the Einstein field equations, as we know them today, but in linearized approximation. And again, Einstein discards them because he doesn't yet understand the physics behind them, so they don't meet his physical criteria, and that's the end of the mathematical strategy in the Zurich notebook. Now comes a different phase. Einstein, for the time being, definitively switches back to the physical strategy and publishes the Entwurf theory that will reign over the remaining 2.5 years. And we have called that the consolidation phase. So in a letter to Bessel, and as I told you, the letters to Bessel are really, you know, telling, he writes, "The general theory of invariance, this wonderful mathematics of the Riemann tensor and so on, only proved to be an obstacle. The direct route proved to be the only feasible one. The only thing that is incomprehensible is that I had to feel my way around for so long before I found the obvious." What is the obvious? The physical, the outline, the Entwurf strategy. In November 15, 2 years later, Einstein would write a similar letter to Bessel, almost with the same wording, but now the obvious is the mathematics. So what are the advantages and disadvantages of this N-dwarf theory? So, as we have seen, it contains Newton's equation for the gravitational potential as a limit case, and it satisfies energy-momentum constant. So it is a physically solid theory. The extent to which that theory fulfills Einstein's dream of a generalization of the relativity principle, how its formalism behaves under coordinate transformations, that was entirely unclear. But okay, here you have a research program, and that is what Einstein did with his N-dwarf theory in the following 2 years. Yeah, explore the N-dwarf theory. Now, indeed, he did so. And of course, not much of it is known because it's a wrong theory from today's point of view, but it turned out, as you will see, very fruitful. So one of the things that Einstein did in the summer of 1913, together with his friend Michele Besso, is to tackle this problem of the perihelion shift of Mercury. He developed the full formalism that he would later reuse in the context of the correct theory, but he got an erroneous result. The result was too small. It didn't explain the astronomically observed effects. And we can reconstruct that in great detail because we have Besso's notebook on Einstein's, on the collaboration with Einstein and on the conversations that he had with Einstein. So he never mentioned that, but he had the formalism ready. And he was preparing for a grand keynote lecture that he was presenting to the German Association of Physicians and Natural Researchers in Vienna in the year. So he was, you know, working on the weak spots of the N-dwarf theory to present it for the first time to a grand public. And in fact, Einstein's keynote lecture there did get a lot of attention, and not from historians of science, because historians of science were not interested, because it's a lecture on the wrong theory. But we went into some depth in exploring, you know, the details and the context. We even tried to reconstruct the music that the participants were listening to. Is that the correct music? Well, it's a bit anachronistic. Actually, what they were listening to was this. Can we? This is an operetta, the gypsy band leader, a thrice-widowed violin virtuoso, engaged in educating his 16 children, adored by women. So we don't know for sure whether Einstein extended it, but we know all the context. Why do we need all the context? Because it's in the newspapers, and in the digital era, all the Vienna newspapers are online, so you can do a detailed research. And Einstein was already then a prominent figure. So for instance, the workers' newspaper wrote about him. Just a year ago, Einstein was working at the University of Prague. From there, he moved to Zurich, and now he's living for Berlin. There, he received a so-called academy professorship. This means that he can devote himself completely to his research without losing most of his time to teaching and exams. In Austria, something like this, of course, is impossible. So, but back to our N-dwarf theory. So the N-dwarf theory, from a modern perspective, has a very strange architecture. So the basic idea is you have somewhere a generally covariant object, so that is mathematically wonderful, and so on and so forth, and then you have a coordinate restriction. It's really valid only for a selected set of coordinates. So Einstein was, of course, very interested in finding those selected coordinates, finding this coordinate restriction, and he did so, again, in collaboration with Marcel Grossmann, a collaboration that extended well into 1914. And they found something else, and that is really exciting. But again, you know, exciting in the wrong context, therefore it's not so known. They found that this coordinate restriction, this special choice of coordinates under which the N-dwarf equations keep their form, remain covariant, also guarantees that energy momentum is conserved. And those of you who know about Noether's theorem can recognize the seed of Noether's theorem, the relation between symmetries and conservation laws. So that's already built into this N-dwarf theory here. And it gets better. So Einstein is encouraged to this result, and he now writes a review paper about this theory, no longer calling it N-dwarf or outline. He now calls it the general theory, the generalized theory of relativity. And he now derives very elegantly the theory from a variational principle. And That variational principle also allows him to prove energy momentum conservation in a very general and elegant way. He now claims at the end of this paper, we have now in a completely formal manner, that is without direct use of our physical knowledge about gravity, arrived at very definite field equations. So you can see, he now believed that the physical and the mathematical strategies converge, convergence, and that everything is in harmony. So that's the end result? No, we know it's not the end result. So, you know, the theory has reached a state of maturity, but it's not the end of the story. So then comes a phase of reflection. Einstein is in Berlin. Of course, he went to Berlin in the hope of discussing his results with the famous colleagues Planck, Lauer, and so on in Berlin. But to his friend Michele Besso, he writes, the fraternity of physicists behaves rather passively with respect to my gravitation paper. Lauer is not open to the fundamental considerations, and neither is Planck, while Sommerfeld is more likely to be so, not sure. A free, unprejudiced look is not at all characteristic of the adult German. Blinders, he says. So it's very interesting. So Einstein goes to Berlin also in the hope to interact with this famous physicist, but actually the ones who remain in touch with him is Grossmann, Besso, and some other not so well-known physicists. And of course there are the competitors, because that's a story that I haven't told you about. Einstein was not alone in pursuing this. There was Max Abraham, there was Gunnar Nordström, and as we shall see, there was David Hilbert. So this was also a competitive arrangement. So you can see no lonely genius here. You know, Einstein has his collaborations, there are frustrations with the colleagues, and there is competition. So then thinking about the mature and wolf theory, Einstein finds that his, you know, ultimate achievements, supposedly ultimate achievement, namely that this theory is unique and mathematically without alternatives, is actually wrong. But this was not just a setback. It also provided an opportunity, because now he had a fully elaborate formalism for this theory, this variational formalism, which also gave him energy conservation, the Newtonian limit and everything, and he could now tinker and play around with this formalism and see whether it admitted alternatives. So it is in that sense that the Entwurf field equations could, with this elaborate, you know, formalism around them, serve as a scaffold for the final theory of gravitation. And now I'm going to talk just a little bit how that scaffold then turned into the beautiful arch of the final theory. Again, you don't have to understand the technicalities, but I will tell you that what Einstein did, he replaced what he identified as the gravitational field in the Entwurf theory by a different expression for the gravitational field, as you can see, a somewhat more complex expression, the Christoffel symbols, as they are called. And he inserted those expressions into the variational formalism he had developed for the Entwurf theory, and bang, he got the final theory out of it. Not quite the final theory, but with a little adjustment, it turned out to be the final theory. So really, the formalism he had elaborated for the Entwurf theory served him as a scaffold that would produce, with a little modification, the final result of general relativity. And there's actually evidence that this is the way that he did find those final field equations, because in the 1915 paper, in the first one, he says he refers exactly to these expressions, to the Christoffel symbols, and to his earlier identification of the gravitational field. He says, this was a fateful prejudice. And to Sommerfeld, he wrote, just 3 days after he had submitted the final paper, the key to this solution was my realization that not this expression, but the related Christoffel symbols are to be regarded as the natural expression for the components of the gravitational field. But he had to come that far, develop the formalism to this extent, before being able to just switch the identification of the gravitational field in order to go from the Entwurf theory, erroneous theory from modern point of view, to the final field equation. So if we look now again at this passage, which we already saw, that I completely lost confidence in the Entwurf equations, I was thus led back to the demand of a more general covariance, hardly anybody who understood the theory will be able to avoid coming under its spell, and so on and so forth. We no longer see that as a switch from a physical to a mathematical strategy, but we see it as Einstein hiding the arch that had helped to build the beautiful Einstein hiding the scaffold that had helped him to build the beautiful arch of general relativity. And of course, he was entitled to hide it because it no longer made sense to explain to his audience of colleagues a theory that he had superseded himself. So, let us look again at my central thesis, general relativity as a transformation of classical physics. So the Entwurf theory we have seen served as a scaffold for general relativity. It offered a formalism that helped him bring together his conceptual insights, but he now also could adjust his conceptual ideas to the new formalism. He learned actually something very important by elaborating this formalism. And which are the things that he learned? One of the things that he learned is the Newtonian limit that was always, the touchstone of his endeavors, because this is where you make contact with the physics, it is actually attained differently from what he had expected. And that he could learn from the Entwurf theory. And the other thing that he learned is that he had conceived of the restricted covariance of the Entwurf theory also always as related to energy momentum conservation, which again seemed to impose an additional restriction on the theory. But now he had learned that there was this intimate connection between conservation and covariance, and that when you have the right field equation, you get the conservation laws for free. So these are deep conceptual insights, as I told you, the latter one closely related to Noether's theorem that Einstein gained from elaborating the Entwurf theory. So, now there, you might ask, you might wonder, and I don't leave this for question time, what about David Hilbert? David Hilbert is usually known as having anticipated Einstein by 5 days in the formulation of the final field equation, because Hilbert's paper is dated 20th of November 1913, Einstein's paper is dated 25th November of 1915. Both dates are the dates where they presented their theories to the Prussian Academy in Einstein's case, the Göttingen Academy in Hilbert's case. But fortunately, we have been able to find the proofs that Hilbert's paper before he published it, and the proofs are dated 6 December. So the proofs are later than Einstein's final publication. But more importantly is that the theory that we still see in the proofs follows the logic of the Entwurf theory, where you have, as I explained, energy momentum condition, not for free, but as an additional condition imposed on the theory to restrict its covariance. And here you can see that Hilbert introduced an additional axiom by which the admissible coordinates of space and time are selected by a special non-generally covariant condition for energy momentum conservation. So the structure of Hilbert is similar to that of the Entwurf theory, and still at a conceptual distance from the final theory of general relativity. So I would say he did not build the arch or compete with Einstein about the arch, but he perfected the scaffold. But I hope you understand that this is not diminishing his efforts and his achievements. Building the scaffold is really essential for building an arch. Now, is this the happy end of this story? Hilbert and Einstein, quarreled for a while because Einstein feared that Hilbert wanted to steal his priority, but then they reconciled and the story was okay. But was this the happy end? There's a lot of stories that I couldn't tell you so far. There's the confirmation of light bending by the Eddington expedition in 1919. There is Einstein holding on to a static universe while others were discovering that the universe is actually expanding, taking his own theory and using it against Einstein's prejudices. So there's a lot to tell. But, I have not time to go into the details here. I want to make a jump forward in time and look at this whole history from a wider angle. So when you consider the aftermath of the creation of general relativity, apart from the few successes that I mentioned, gravitational light bending, the confirmation of the expanding universe, it can be considered as a low watermark period, as a period in which not so much happened, at least not on a big scale. There was no community really around the theory that was working on it. But that changed in the 50s when new astrophysical discoveries were made, when the quasars were discovered, and when all of a sudden general relativity became a very important theory for astrophysics and cosmology. And this has been called the Renaissance of general relativity. Now, for a historian of science, it's interesting, how does this Renaissance come about? Was it the sugar daddy scenario, just big money flowing into physics after the war, Cold War physics? Was it a sleeping beauty, the sleeping beauty being general relativity and the prince being the newly discovered quasars that woke up this, you know, sleeping theoretical community that there is actually something out there in the world? I would argue for a different scenario, namely, and I think this is very much in line with what is being done here at the Perimeter Institute, it's a network or teamwork scenario. So let's, in the closure of this lecture, let me just briefly look at the development of general relativity in this critical period of its renaissance. So let's first hear the voice of one of the protagonists of this time, John Sinch. He wrote in 63, in those 50 years, the progress, referring to the progress of general relativity, that has been made is less than one might expect. Another reason is perhaps to be found in the scientific unrest of the 20th century. Old theories have been broken up, and the infection of this destructive zeal has incited many to try to modify the new theories. Einstein himself devoted many years to the modification of his 1916 theory. So general relativity was, you know, not considered to be engraved in stone, but people took it, tried to build a quantum theory from it, tried to build a unified field theory from it, and for Sinch this was a destructive zeal. Now, it is true there is some truth to the sugar daddy scenario, because there's an enormous growth of the population of PhDs in physics. There is also the new mechanism of postdocs that travel from one center to the others, and indeed new centers are being established. But none of these centers is really focused on general relativity exclusively. They're doing these things, unified field theory, quantum theory, cosmology. So general relativity as a subject is still dispersed in this community. And that you also see from the publications. So there is a remarkable rise in the number of publications, but if you look at how they are distributed, you find that 1,400 papers are distributed over more than 200 journals in, six different languages, including Esperanto. So, you know, there is really no coherence here. And another indication is that the first important conference bringing together the relativist community, which turns out to happen in the year of Einstein's death in 1955, but was meant to celebrate the 50th anniversary of special relativity in Bern, where it had been created, you know, it took some effort to create this conference. It was not an evident thing like it is today to celebrate the centenary of general relativity. So a recent Nobel Prize winner, Wolfgang Pauli, writes to Pascal Jordan, one of the co-creators of quantum mechanics, in spring 1955, we want to hold a Congress on Relativity Theory and Cosmology in Bern. Because of the 50th anniversary of Einstein's work in Bern, there is actually a chance of getting money for this. Can you believe this? I think, you know, conveys something of the difficulties of the time. It turned out to be a very influential conference, and it turned out to be the first of a series. So people got together, you know, many conferences, small meetings, and of course there are institutions created. There's the International Society on General Relativity and Gravitation, and there are also publications, bulletins, proceedings. So there is a knowledge network created around general relativity, and that really changes things. And just an example how in this new network that is being established, information about general relativity traveled much more quickly. You can see, you know, the Kerr solution, which is very important to describe rotating black holes and what went into the Kerr solution. You know, one of the important things is a mathematical technique for classifying solutions, the Petrov classification that was, it was invented many times, but one of the crucial inventions was by Petrov in Kazan, which is a remote area. Then he traveled to London, where Pirani took it up, and then from there, Roy Kerr got hold of it. So in this network, you know, information even traveled from marginal science across the world. And that invigorated, really, the relativity conference, the relativity community. And, you know, if you want to say it very succinctly, you can say, you know, before the renewal, before this renaissance, people followed Einstein's example, tinkering around with relativity, trying to go beyond it. After the renewal, people followed Einstein's theory. And now it is really in the center of a vigorous community of relativists, and it is the basis for modern cosmology, astrophysics, and it's one of the fundamental theories of physics. And if you want to learn more about it, I recommend you some books. that, you know, comment on Einstein's work and of the history of which I only could give you some glimpses here. And with this, I thank you very much for your attention.
All right, we'll open the floor to questions, and let's take one from in studio.
Thanks, Professor Renn, for a great talk. Dan Falk, we Skyped about a week ago. And my question is, can you just elaborate a bit on the role of Mach, the role of Mach's philosophy? To what extent was Einstein worried about Mach's principle when he was developing general relativity?
So Mach's principle is a term that was coined by Einstein, not by Mach. So Mach reviewed the foundations of classical mechanics in a rather sober way, and he tried to purge it from metaphysical notions, such as the notion of absolute space. He didn't want such speculative metaphysical entities to have a role in physical interactions. So he realized, and in particular some of his followers realized, that really doing this profoundly would mean to reformulate even classical mechanics, not talk about relativity and things like that, but even classical mechanics had to be reformulated in order to fully comply with this principle that only material bodies have that. And that's been has been a project in physics itself, and I think we are fortunate here that Julian Barber here is among us, who has pursued this line, you know, going back to Mach into the modern world and trying to bring this into touch with Einstein's effort. Now, for Einstein, this was a big encouragement that his ideas about extending the relativity principle to accelerated motion were not just lofty and speculative ideas, but he found in Mach a very important testimony, an authority that encouraged him to pursue this route. Now, one thing distinguished Einstein from Mach and his followers: Einstein didn't think of realizing these interactions as we would say today, action at a distance, as point-to-point interaction. He was strongly believing in field theory, so he tried to incorporate these ideas of Mach into the language that he had learned, of course, as I tried to point out from electromagnetism, into a field theory of gravitation. So Einstein had it really both ways. He was influenced by Mach as a critique of classical mechanics, but also by the tradition of field theory. I think that's very characteristic for Einstein, that he was, you know, a convergence thinker. So he brought different traditions together.
Thank you. Okay, let's go online. And this question is one that I've asked you just before the lecture. Did you work with digitized copies of his notebooks or with his actual notebooks? And what was the experience of examining the actual documents?
Yes, we have, partly I've looked, of course, also at the actual documents, but today we are in the fortunate situation that we have high-quality facsimiles. By the way, they're online, so you can look for the Einstein archives online, and you can see really high-quality facsimile reproductions of these notebooks. And it's, of course, very exciting, but it's also frustrating, I have to admit, because Einstein wrote these notes, of course, for himself and perhaps for Grossman, but he certainly didn't write it for somebody else, let alone a historian to read them. So there are calculations, there are numbers, you know, they're without any comment very often. And it's really hard, and it did take us several years in a team to figure out what they mean. And we had one rule that we followed, and that we called the chicken scratch rule, which means that we would only believe that we had understood a page if we could explain every chicken scratch on it, every little spot on it.
Excellent, thank you. Let's go back in studio.
Hi, thank you for the talk tonight. It was great. I have a question about Einstein's way of evaluating his generalized theory as he's developing it. You mentioned a couple times he was on the right path and got close, but then when he kind of considered that in the limit and tried to match it up with classical physics, it didn't match up, and so he turned away. And you also mentioned, I think, one of the conceptual insights that he gained and had to gain when he finally came to his final general theory was that the way you consider it in the limit was different than he originally thought. Can you talk a little bit about how he came to that realization and sort of overcame that barrier of evaluation?
Yeah. First of all, his criteria seem very reasonable. You know, you have to make you have to be in touch with the established physics, what you know about gravitation. But then there is also the issue of consistency. A theory has to be free of contradiction, has to be plausible, has to be a closed theory. But there are always unexpected surprises. And the way that the Newtonian limit is to be achieved was one of these unexpected surprises. So Einstein expected that from the field equations of this generalized theory, he should be able to get the Poisson equation, which is, you know, the potential form of Newton's law of gravitation. So he always checked his field equations whether he could extract the Poisson equation of classical physics from it. Actually, when you have the final theory, and what is characteristic about the Poisson equation is it just has one scalar gravitational potential. When you do this procedure with the final theory, and this was one of the reasons why he discarded it at first when he first hit upon it in 1913, is you get more components. The gravitational, in the weak static case, the gravitational tensor, the metric tensor, has more components than this one scalar potential that you need and that you want in order to recover the Poisson equation. But then Einstein found out that these other components are not relevant for the equation of motion in that approximation. How did he learn that? So the Newtonian limit is not achieved through simply reducing the field equation to the Poisson equation, but you have to look at the interplay between field equation and equation of motion. How did he learn that? And that's very interesting. He learned that by elaborating the perihelion problem. So the perihelion problem necessitated to develop an approximation scheme for the resolution of the field equation in which he could see how this really worked. And it is hence only after he had done that that he understood that he could accept a weak static limit that did not take the expected form. And this is an interesting detail that you see. The last paper before the final paper, dated 18th November 1915, it's about the perihelion motion. And there you find a footnote to this paper where he says, soon I will, you know, overcome the last barrier to achieving a fully covariant theory because now I have understood how this has been done. So you can really see that it is in the context of the perihelion calculation that Einstein realized how to attain the Newtonian limit.
Thank you. Okay, let's go back to an online question. And the question is, do you believe current schooling does enough justice to the process of science in terms of Einstein's relativity? That is, do you believe the contributors get short shrift?
I think that is true. In particular, one tends to just isolate a hero, worship him, think of his genius and the great creativity, and not seeing, you know, what an interesting playful process science really is, how many people can contribute to it without being an Einstein, and what it really takes to bring out such a theory. It's a collaborative process, as I have tried to show you. It's an interaction between people with different perspectives, and so science is also this communicative process, and that is usually not the way that it's being taught.
All right, well, let's finish with one last question from the Twitter feed, and the question is this, and I apologize, it's a tough one. What questions do you think Einstein would be grappling with today if he were still alive?
I just hope he would not insist, you know, pursuing his route to the unified field theories, ignoring all the wonderful things that have come out along other pathways in physics. But I think he would have been very happy in participating in this conference and see what marvelous results general relativity has given rise to.
That's good.